Hi, this is Freddy from Switzerland with another knife video, and today we're going to do a full collection overview of my knife collection, some EDC stuff as well. And we're doing this just at the beginning of 2022. Actually, we're having the 4th of January of 2022 today. And this is going to be my 2021 knife collection overview. So this will be a little bit a longer video overall. First off, I'm going to show you how I store my knives and over some miscellaneous gear things that are connected in some way to my knife collection hobby, and we'll start off right here. So if you have watched my last collection overview, I dare show you my storage system a little bit in depth, and I also have a knife storage video on my channel. You can see it here in the link right at the top right corner if you're interested. But I basically have a 1520 Pelican case where I had these nice tray inserts with foam made for it. So I actually have four layers. I have the bottom layer and then three of these knife trays, and then I store them in the lowest drawer. There are the least expensive knives, and then it goes up to the customs in the top layer for the knives that I have in storage and have not in regular carry and use or carry for review. Now here on this first kind of shot I laid out for you guys, I have my EDC wallet case, something from Mujo, a brand that I support for quite a while now. They are from Amsterdam and they have some great accessories for all kinds of Apple products, for laptops, iPads, and also phones. And this is a great wallet where you can actually carry some cards and have your phone nicely protected. It's pretty well beaten up, but I really like the case. And if I get a new phone, I will probably get another Mujo wallet case. Then to take apart my knives, I use this very cool looking Weiha bit case or set that is actually made in conjunction with Xiaomi, which is a phone and electronic company from China, I believe. And these are very nice Weiha bits, very nicely stored in this aluminum shell right here. And of course I have two of them, so if I have a free spinning pivot, it's easy to manipulate that with this very cool and nice looking Weiha bit driver set. Of course it's a little bit more expensive than if you just get your regular Weiha bit sets, but I can store this very nicely in this foam shell thing. I had it made so it would fit the Weiha bit set as well. In terms of lubrication, I pretty much always use knife pivot lube. I have these two here. I have some other bottles as well, but these are the ones that I keep in the storage compartment that are not at the moment in use. The regular kind of knife pivot lube, and then the heavy that I mostly use on the detent ball and the detent track. So these are my primary lubrication solutions that I use. And then I also have some pry bars. I have this one here. This is a Mazarin Croco tool made from steel, so you have a little bit of a wrench possibility, and then a pretty nice and fine scraping tool and pry bar end, and some pre-wrapped paracord that comes actually with it. So I have that in here as well. And then a thing that I carry all the time in my winter jacket is this little EDC case that is with a brass Fisher Space Pen without any clip or anything, and you can see it's very nicely patinaed. Then I have another pry bar that I actually really like, that is this one here. This is the Glow Rhino pry tool, I think that's the name. It's made from titanium, it has a tritium insert and just a cool overall design, has a cap lifter as well, and just fits very nice in this little leather wallet thing that is actually a wallet made by Das Offenmeer Leather, or now called Open Sea Leather. Very cool, nice like green camo-ish color here on the leather, very nicely done. And then I also have a Cadet in here as well. So this is like a mini EDC kit that I always have in my jacket if I am somewhere where I don't carry a regular primary knife, or when I forgot it in the house. Then I have a couple of flashlights. Not a lot of has changed here. I have the S1R from Olight, 850 lumen. This is the titanium version, winter edition. That has also the charging capability. Then I have a S1 mini in the HCRI version, so the warmer kind of light. This is what I use normally in reviews to illuminate the insides of knives. And then I also have the newest one in the collection, is this one here. This is a Raylite Pineapple Mini, which is actually a very impressive little light. Lots of power in this light available. Can get extremely bright, as you can see here. Comes in a lot of different materials. This one is brass. There's also titanium ones available, I believe even copper. You have a tail switch, you have a great pocket clip, and these are actually pretty inexpensive. So I'm very happy with this one. And the great thing is it's easier to carry in the pocket because they are not as fat as the Olight. So that's what's the main reason why I actually went with a Raylite. So that is certainly a very interesting light, and I'm happy to have it in the collection. Then my only small kind of EDC or just smaller pocketable fixed blade is this one here. I normally do not carry it. It lives mainly on my table here. But this is the Little Warning by Dirk Pinkerton, a full custom Warncliffe fixed blade with an extremely thin cutting edge. Nice hollow grind, gorgeous Vegas Forge Matrix Damascus blade, and a carbon fiber handle. Comes with a Kydex sheath, but I normally just have it out here to open some things real quick here that I have on my desk. But you have to see the tip is incredibly thin. Just an amazing piece of work and just something gorgeous to actually look at. And that's living on my desk, and I'm super happy that I actually have this gorgeous Little Warning in my collection. And this will stay for a long, long time. Then my wallet is the Das Offenmeer or OpenSea leather gun deck. Have this now for a long, long time. Love to carry this. I just now have implemented some Apple AirTags into my EDC system on my keys, and I would love to put it on the wallet as well. And I just asked him if he could implement an AirTag into his designs. I would love to upgrade to something like that in the future if he makes that available. Then I have some two miscellaneous knives that live in this, in the bottom kind of drawer of the collection bin, and that is this one here. This was the first knife I ever got, now about 9 years ago, which is the Kershaw and RJ Martin Chill, which is a manual liner lock flipper, a bit modeled after his Q36 model. Very small kind of steak knife-esque, pretty standard kind of clip. It also has a attempt on a kind of polish hand drop finish thing going on. Was a good knife at the time, but certainly something very inexpensive and something I do not carry anymore. I just keep it around because this was actually what got me into the knife game. And the guy that got me primarily into the knife game is my brother and Nothing Fancy. I actually got this off a video from Nothing Fancy that recommended it and reviewed it. And yeah, that's actually the start of the channel, a like $15 or $20 Kershaw Chill. So that's still in the collection and will not go away. And then something I got in a trade a long time ago. This is a Boecker Keycom with Cuscadi aftermarket copper strike, lightning strike, carbon fiber scales. Super small knife, I believe 440C on the steel or OS 8 on the steel. Just too cute and funny to give away or to sell. And this is just lives here, is not really carried. I think it's a Chad Los Banos design, as you can see here. So very cool little thing. Actually quite amazing that somebody took the time to customize this with this scale, because the scale was certainly more expensive than the knife itself. And it actually has a pretty thin kind of edge here on that OS 8 steel. And also action, as you can see, is actually quite impressive. So now we'll just go over very quick about the pens in the collection. I have here this mechanical pencil from Modern Fuel. Very cool titanium mechanical pencil, something you don't see that often in the EDC world. Very nicely machined, comes with a clip, has even a rubber tip at the end, so very functional if you want to sketch some things. Then from the same company, Modern Fuel, I got their bolt action pen, which is very cool, writes super well, good size. These are my two kind of desk pens at home that I use at home. I think this does not come with a clip, but maybe you can get one aftermarket from Modern Fuel. But these are some full-sized great pens. This one is in brass, this is in titanium, but they have a bunch of different kind of materials available. So really cool and minimalist and very well-designed pens here from Modern Fuel. And then I have some other things that are a bit longer in the collection. I have these Refine Co. bolt action pen, one in brass and one in titanium. This is a thing that I really like to carry because it's a great compact size, very wear resistance finish here on with the stonewash right there. So that's a great pen to carry, and that is just if you have something you want to coordinate with the copper kind of color scheme. So these are great and quite inexpensive bolt action EDC pens with a great clip. Then I have some pens that I have longer in the collection are these two right here. This is a Peter Döring and Lionsteel made mini pen with one extension at the end. Great deep carry clip, nice bolt action mechanism. This is also something I really like to carry. Looks a bit like a Shirokorov design for me. Very nice and compact, great to write with, very comfortable. So this is a bit harder to get. I don't think these are produced anymore, but certainly a gorgeous titanium pen. Then I have another Lionsteel made pen, the Niala pen here with super dense twist Damascus on this little tube here. They were also available with carbon fiber and some nicely anodized bronze anodized titanium. This was actually a gift from my girlfriend. And here you can see you have a twisty at the end, nice 3D milled machined pocket clip as well. And then I have a couple of other Fisher Space Pen, one with a clip, one with just the regular kind of non-clipped version. Gorgeous little knurling here around, just a nice pen. And then my most expensive pen here is this one here, that is the Tactile Turn BAM in full zirconium. So very, very nice and expensive, pretty heavy little pen, but just so well machined. And this was also a gift or a birthday present from my girlfriend, and this is just pretty much the perfect pen in my opinion. Lives on the desk, sometimes it also gets carried, but it's just an absolutely gorgeous piece. I'm just a big fan of zirconium, and Tactile Turn did a great job on this bolt action pen in full zirconium. Now let's go to the fixed blade collection that hasn't really changed from last year. I'm not a big guy into the fixed blades. This is of course also a fixed blades, but was covered earlier. And then we have these four in the collection. First off, the least expensive one is this one here. This is the Kaiser Knives Little River Bowie, also designed by Dirk Pinkerton, the same guy who made the little warning right here. But this is a custom, and this is a production knife by Kaiser. But this is probably one of the nicest and most inexpensive fixed blades I have seen from a company that I really absolutely adore. The ergonomics are amazing, super great size, very gorgeous and functional blade shape. The steel is 1095 high carbon, so good tough steel for outdoor use. You have a rough kind of coating on there, so it's going to protect from rusting. You see I have mine a little bit oiled, very sharp steel, good jimping on the back, very, very nice and functional blade, and just very well executed by Kaiser Knives. Absolutely gorgeous, and I think these are around $100, so very inexpensive. They have just done a great job on those G10 handles, fit and finish and everything, and the design is just super gorgeous as well as really functional, and you get a great kind of Kydex sheath with it that works really well. Great retention, so nothing to complain there. Even got a drainage hole there, and this Kydex kind of clip comes as well. So full package for around $100 from Kaiser and Dirk Pinkerton. If you're looking for an inexpensive, nicely sized, do-it-all kind of camp knife, and this is a great option in my opinion. Then we have this one here. Probably the most used of these is the Southern Grind Jackal, full-size Jackal, absolutely super ergonomic blade. I don't even know if they still make these. Absolutely gorgeous G10 handle scales that really are super ergonomic, great jimping. They have their special sawmill blade steel. The 5670M, these are made in the US from some old sawmills that they found nearby where they are made in Peachtree, Georgia. Some gorgeous Cerakote here with that FDE, and just an absolutely gorgeous and super beefy blade. Very, very tough. I did a lot of batoning with this, and you can see that the coating and everything held up quite well. So this is my favorite kind of hard use beater knife from Southern Grind. You even have a color matching Kydex sheath with a drainage hole clip on the end there. So very, very cool, and will stay in the collection very long. You even have the coating on the screws right there, pommel at the end, really well done, nice and full tang construction. The same of course goes for this one here, also a full tang construction. Then this one here, this is a custom fixed blade that I had made for me with a very nice retaining Kydex sheath as well. This one here is a custom knife from TK Knives out of the Czech Republic. Absolutely super ergonomic handle. This really melts in the hand, fits my hand perfectly. Super thinly ground carbon steel. It's their proprietary carbon steel that they do themselves. You got some red liners in there. Gorgeous micarta handles, and this is the best kind of bushcrafting knife I have. Super nice to do feather sticking with and everything. Absolutely gorgeous piece. This is the Telhar model, and I have a video on all of these knives on the channel, so check that out if you're interested in some more details. Then we have this one here, which is the newest edition, but I had it also last year. This is a Bark River Gunny Sidekick designed by the Apostle P, which is also a very well-known YouTube personality, and I just thought this was an absolutely gorgeous knife. I never had a Bark River before, and that's why I picked this up. This is actually in 3V, so a very tough kind of steel. Gorgeous handle, very comfortable. And it's actually the V2. The V1 had a super exaggerated sharpening chisel because that is a little bit of a thing of the Apostle P, but I think this is the nicer version, and it also has this very Bark River-esque convex grind, and it's just an absolutely gorgeous clip point blade, and just an absolutely gorgeous blade. I haven't really used this so far, just handled it a couple of times, so I can't really speak for its performance, but it was just a fixed blade I wanted to have in the collection because it has a connection to the YouTube community. It looks absolutely great, and I didn't have anything from Bark River, which is a pretty big name in the world of fixed blades. So that's why I have this Gunny Sidekick in the collection, and I just think it's an absolutely gorgeous knife here with the orange liners and the canvas micarta handle scales as well as the brass pins. So these are the fixed blades of the collection, and now let's get to the main course. So now we are at the kind of lowest tier of that 1520 Pelican case, the like least expensive knives I have in the collection. And you see here the overview just laid out on my reviewing mat, and we'll just start from the top here on the right. Here we have the very well-known and just absolutely excellent Protec Malibu. Amazing button lock flipper in 20 CV. I have the Warncliffe blade version, which I think is the much more fitting blade and much more much nicer blade on the Malibu. I see more and more, or just like mainly the reverse tanto blade being promoted and shown, but I think this is the better blade shape, and I'm very happy to have this Protec in the collection, also because I can't really have a lot of automatic knives, so that's pretty much the only Protec I can have, and I look forward to have some more manual Protecs in the future. Of course, also clip is amazing on most Protecs. Then we have a ZT, the only ZT in the collection. This is the 0609. This is an RJ Martin design, as well as the first knife I ever had, which is this one here, the Chill, which is also an RJ Martin design, as you can see. And this is just an absolutely gorgeous blade, especially the blade itself just has an amazing grind going on, and that's the main reason why it still is in the collection, together with the great ergonomics for my hand size. I have the tool to take it apart, so that's no longer an issue there. I had to swap out the clip to a great MXG deep carry clip, but this is a great knife to carry, also 20 CV, and I think pretty much the best knife that ZT has made in a long time. Love how it carries, it's nice and thin, some good standoffs in the back there, and a great ZT kind of action, and also quite thin behind the edge for a ZT, so this is actually a great folder to carry and use, and that's why it's still in the collection. Then we have a Spyderco, of the few Spydercos I have in the collection. This is the Spidey Chef, the first knife I think that features the LC200N steel. Very nice and slicey blade, gorgeous design by Martin Swish, and just a great Spyderco. I love the design, I love the ergonomics, great clip, great interesting steel, and just a fun knife to have around, carry and use, and it's the nicest and best priced Martin Swish collaboration that Spyderco has ever done, and that's why it's still in the collection. I had some others that have been sold in the past. Then we have the Hogue Knives K320. This is a newer addition to the collection. This is a collaboration from Sig Sauer and Hogue, and was a knife that really surprised me. I got it in the show and tell video series for an overview, and then I decided I needed to have this in the collection as a great user, just because the ergonomics are amazing on this interesting polymer handle scale that is the same polymer as the P320 pistol by Sig Sauer. It has an S30V blade, it has the able lock, super smooth, middle finger flickable, good size, great clip, some smoothed out stippling here underneath where the clip lands, four-way positionable, just an overall great user here from Hogue and Sig Sauer, and the knife that really surprised me, and also part of the top 10 knives of the year list for me. Then I have this one here. This is also a knife that came out this year. This is the Mini Adamus by Benchmade and Shane Siebert in crewware. Very beefy knife, very good looking coating there. Nice size in comparison to the full size. Adamus much more handleable, and great deep carry clip by Benchmade there in their nice wearing parkerized finish. Black G10 access lock, of course. Of course, a little bit of thicker edge there. Ergonomically, it's not as perfect as the Sig Sauer, so that's why I may be selling this one down the line. But at the moment, still part of the collection and a fun knife to carry and have around. And it's just a good-looking design by Benchmade for sure. I really like some of the aesthetics that Shane Sieber does also on his customs, but those are very hard to get and very expensive. Then one of the longest members of the collection here, we have the Burkhardt Plus and Charles Marlowe designed Bullpup, one of the best knives that Burkhardt has ever made, in my opinion. Super, super great ergonomics. It's a bit on the heavy side, but it has a reversible pocket clip for tip up or tip down carry. This is probably the only knife I carry tip down, just because I like the pocket clip landing on the titanium bolster. Overall fit and finish is good, not perfect. There are some issues, for example, with the alignment of the jimping from the bolsters and the liners there. Great micarta handle scales with titanium bolsters. A very, very beefy liner lock running on phosphor bronze washers. Great angled, massive thumb stud that works super well. Good jimping there, and just an absolutely gorgeous design here. Hollow ground blade, I believe it's VG10. Yes, it's VG10. And just a very well executed model here by Burkhardt, and just an amazing design by Charles Marlowe, which you pretty much cannot get at any reasonable price or just in terms of availability. But if somebody has a custom Marlowe Bullpup or bull available, just hit me up. I will see what I can do to make this happen, because this would certainly be an absolute grail for me, a full custom Marlow bullpup. So that's why this is standing in until that maybe happens someday. We also have a nice aluminum backspace. So all around, great knife by Boecker. If you have the possibility to get one of these, go for it. It's just an absolutely well-made knife by Boecker Plus. Then here we have another Spyderco. We have the Reinhold Rhino, very nice small knife. I certainly prefer this over the little Native, for example. Great ergonomics, full four-finger grip, nice place for your thumb. Even if you do like pull cuts like this, you just have to, I repeat, you have to replace the pocket clip with this nice bug out pocket clip. With that, it's an amazing knife. It carries great. You have not like this much sticking out of the pocket. With that clip, it's a totally changed knife, and it's the only reason it's still in the collection. If I had the regular pocket clip on it, this would have gotten sold, but now I really love it. Great backup knife, great minimal carry knife, and it also has the compression lock on there, and I believe it's CTS XHP on the steel. Yeah, CTS XHP, so great steel, nice and thin cutting edge. Just a great knife for smaller pockets and for more minimalist types of carries. Before we go further in this video, I just want to point out that most of these knives actually have their own video on the channel. So if you're interested in some more details on these knives, please check out their individual videos. And also don't forget to follow me at 7ready_knife_reviews on Instagram, and follow me here on YouTube if you like this content and you want to see more knife related content on this channel. So thanks again for that. Also, put in the comments what you're looking forward to in 2022 in terms of knife purchases or additions to your knife storage, EDC loadout like pens, wallets, or things like that, or if you have any other questions to the channel and moving forward. So that would be highly appreciated. I read all the comments and I also answer them. So this knife right here is also a longer stay-in in the collection. This is a Ken Onion design. I believe the only Ken Onion design I still have left in the collection. This is the CRKT Ripple 2. This is actually the old CRKT logo if you compare it to how it looks now here, for example, on the Thinco. So this is the old CRKT logo. It shows you that this is an older knife. Also in the collection here, because of a recommendation from a Not Fancy, this just is a great knife. And they were actually, at the time when I bought this, coming down from a pretty overpriced price tag of over $100 to around $50. And I think for that price, these are great knives. They have the IKBS bearing system. They have a Ken Onion design, absolutely gorgeously executed stainless steel frame lock handle, amazingly thin, so great in terms of carry, but the clip sucks a little bit and is a little bit high carry. Here you can see the IKBS logo on the pivot, some nice standoffs, a Kudo 440 steel, which is a higher end steel for CRKT and actually has held up quite nice. You also get a hollow grind, great fine tip, rounded spine. So this is just a great knife from CRKT, probably the best thing that the old CRKT has made, and still has a very impressive action for a knife of this era. And it's just a great design and goes pretty well with the ZT here in terms of overall looks. But that is just a little bit of a sentimental thing, a little bit of blast of the past, and just a nice reminder where the knife industry has come from. And I like to have an old CRKT in the collection. So very cool knife here from Ken Onion, and actually still a great piece at the time of recording. Then some more recent things in the collection. I think I added this one this or end of last year. This is the Banter by Wee Knives and Ben Peterson. Here you have his What Is Up Guys logo, S35VN G10. Great little knife, good deep carry clip with the Banter on there. I really like this kind of color scheme. This is also a knife that has some connection to the YouTube knife community with Ben Peterson, that also worked for quite a long time at CRKT and then at Blade HQ. So very, very cool knife. And it's actually, in terms just Judging the knife, it actually is a very good EDC blade. It's a very nice kind of Keppert style blade shape, nice and thin cutting edge, good steel. The action is really well dialed in, very well made by Wii knives. Have some countersunk liners or some nested liners there. Very, very functional and good action. Easy to flick out, easy to disengage, you can even middle finger flick it, and it has a good size for a kind of EDC urban kind of knife. So I really actually like this knife more and more the longer I have it in the collection, and that's why it certainly is one that is staying in the collection, even though it is not like particularly an exciting design or doing something new and different, and just doing things that work and are well thought out in a good way. So it's a great user and just a very cool knife, and because it has some connection with Ben Peterson and the YouTube knife community, this is something that will be staying in the collection for a long time. Then another member of the best knives of 2021 video is this one here. This is the CRKT Cinco. I think the best knife that CRKT has made this year. Richard Rogers design, D2 blade, steel IKBS bearings, and just a gorgeous design, very, very close to the custom Cinco. Just has some nice little touches, great and fun action, good and slender design, blade hides pretty much completely in the handle, and a good clip as well, and just fits the hand really well for a more gentleman style carry at a budget. So this is certainly a great folder, and that's why it's still in the collection as well. Then Wii knife Miscreant 3.0. This is a knife that got booted from the top 10 list in the last couple of days by some other entries, but this is also a great knife from Wii Knife, great new addition for this year, much better than the original Miscreant in my opinion. It's a Brad Zinker design, 20 CV blade steel, full titanium handles with his pretty characteristic hole pattern there. Great action, some exposed stop pins here. Just a very, very cool minimalist design, very user-friendly overall blade finish as well as handle finish, nice and slim carry, good clip, a bit on the stiff side, but other than that, very well executed, and a nice full flat ground blade with a nice thin edge. So this is certainly also a great knife to get. I wish they would polish these larger holes on both sides, which they haven't done, but other than that, pretty cool knife and a great carry piece that also gets some use. Then another member of the top 10 knives list, this is the Quist Bladeworks Variant PE, made by QSP and designed by Mr. Lundquist, Jacob Lundquist, not Justin Lundquist. I don't think that they are related in any way, but this is a great modern interpretation of a swayback design. Has JG10 handle scales, a liner lock running on bearings, and has a great budget steel with 14C28N, as you can see here on the blade. Satin finished blade, nice and thinly ground, just a great EDC piece, fits the hand very well. They managed to do this swayback pattern in a way that is adding to the ergonomics instead of detracting from it. Easy disengagement, it could maybe be a tiny bit more cut down, but for my use it actually works great. I can come in from the side, and you see it's very fidgetable as well. And Mr. Lundquist also does custom versions of these knives. Unfortunately, the customs do not come with a clip. This one has one that is very well executed, just misses countersunk screws. Other than that, it's pretty well done, and you don't have internal milling. But for the price that they're charging here at around $70, I really like what they have done here with the Variant PE, and that's why it's a worthy member of the top 10 list for 2021. And we're going forward with another member. This one is a knife from a new company that I haven't known about before. This is a Petrified Fish Scout, G10 handle scales, also 14C28N blade steel. I have to see where it's marked, I believe here on the tank. 14C28N blade steel, front flipper running on bearings, nice and compact, very understated pocket clip here with a nice design, so you don't have any screws poking out there, nice and springy. Great front flipper action, actually. Can even do the reach around, which I don't do that often, or can't do on a lot of my front flipper models, even customs. So the action here is very, very well executed, especially on a small and light blade as we have it here. Some interesting milling on that G10, good ergonomics, great knife here, the Petrified Fish Scout. And these are under $50, so very affordable for 14C28N. Another great budget knife, a little bit more expensive, but just an awesome design. And nothing new for 2021. But just a gorgeous piece. This is the Ferrum Forge and Wee Knife Made Stinger. Absolutely great design. Nitro V blade steel. Nice and stone washed blade. The nice slot in there for some middle finger action. Great ergonomics in the back grip like that, or even in the foregrip. Nice and super finely ground blade. I have the FDE G10 version. There is also carbon fiber and different color G10s available. You have the Ferrum Forge logo on the pivot there. Nice and slim overall. This is a thing that I carry quite a bit nowadays. And here you'll see the Poco clip has some wear on it. Nice deep carry clip, nice and small. Works really great. And of course, it's a liner lock and it runs on bearings. Nice and smooth. Just a great folder here from Ferrum Forge and Wee Knife. Then we have my review or comparison knives. We have the full-size Benchmade Bugout Allen Putman Aftermarket Micarta Scales. Nice deep carry clip. S30V blade steel. Extremely lightweight. Nice and thin blade stock. Of course, one of the most popular knives from Benchmade ever. And that's why it's a great comparison knife, but also in terms of carry and use, this is a cool knife. And a thing that I don't like that much is that the coating always looks dirty. It's very hard to clean it up, so it doesn't look like very foggy and dirty. But other than that, this is a pretty good overall knife by Benchmade, especially with these aftermarket scales. Dresses it up quite a bit and makes it much more comfortable in hand and in manipulation. Size-wise, perfect EDC size, in my opinion, on the full-size Bugout. And then we have the Para 3, also with some aftermarket, I believe, sharp-dressed knives. Micarta Scales also has an aftermarket Lynch deep carry clip. This is the base model with S30V. I actually got the knife, the regular kind of G10 knife gifted by a viewer, and then just dressed it up to be this way. So this is a Para 3, not a Para 2. Nice, small, compact blade. Of course, it carries a bit thick in this dimension because of the large opening hole, but that also makes it very fidget friendly, as you can see. Of course, it features the compression lock right there, and of course you need to change this pocket clip out on these Para 3 models. You know, the regular clip carries very, very high, about like this, so that was not something I could carry and use. But overall, this is a good EDC piece. Of course, if you dress it up like this, it's getting up there in terms of price, but I like to have my review knives a little bit special, so, or comparison knives a little bit special, so I went for that kind of dressed up nature with the Micarta scales there. Then we have another addition for this year, and I believe also a member of the top 10 knives of the year class of this year. This is the Giant Mouse Ace Riv in Micarta Titanium, and I believe M390. I think these are M390 in terms of the steel. Great compact blades here. Great ergonomics if you use the forward finger trowel. Very, very comfortable. Great placing of the gym and the rounded spine. Nice and thin cutting edge. This is like the CRKT Pilar that we always wanted. Amazing fit and finish. Great action on bearings. We have a wire pocket clip, which is super, super functional. Great back spacer. You can actually open it with the thumb, with the flipper. Kind of struggling here with the flipper as well as with the middle finger. You just have to keep your fingers off that lock bar, and then it works great, as you have seen here. Nice milling and just a great workmanship by Riat, and just a great design by Jesper Voxnes and Jens Anzo from Denmark on their Giant Mouse Ace Riff version. I think this is probably the best knife Giant Mouse has made in a long, long time. And the only Giant Mouse that is still in the collection. I had a couple before this one. If you follow the channel, you know which ones. Then we have a couple of slip joints here. We have this one here, also a member of the top 10 knives of 2021 list. This is the HSK Machine Works Lenny's Clip. Great larger slip joint folder with a M390 blade, I think, or S35N, I believe M390 as well. Nice half stop, great clip point blade right there. Titanium bolsters that are integral to the liners, as you can see here. And then we have some great marbled carbon fiber scales. These are also available in a bunch of different versions. I think some of them are even still available. These are, this is a company from New Zealand, and they are made by Concept Knives. They are very open about that, which is always a good thing. And just fit and finish is great, and the design and overall size is just awesome. Very easy to manipulate, and just a great modern traditional in every way. Very easy to open and close, as you see, but it's not I'm not able to open it with one hand. You need to, but you can easily close it with one hand, as you can see right here. So the HSK Machine Works Lenny's Clip. And then we have this one here. This is the Knif by Editions G, Laurent Guillard design, a French knife maker. This has a great wooden handle scale. I can't remember which kind of wood. Brass bolsters, also this little brass hinge at the end, brass liners, 14C28N on the blade steel. Here we have the Laurent Guillard logo, very close to his customs. Here we have the Editions G logo. So a nice, a bit heavier and more traditional kind of European slip joint that I wanted to have in the collection as well. It's also pinned, as you can see. Just a good looking, more traditional kind of slip joint that I wanted to have in the collection. Also quite a bit stronger back spring there, nicely centered, just very smoothly made. You have to be careful, as you have seen before, not to close your blade when you have the hinge like this. That's going to damage your cutting edge there. But just a gorgeous piece here, the Editions G Knif by Laurent Guillard and Editions G. So very cool. And that will almost wrap it up for this kind of layer. We have some fun micro automatics here. We have the Berker Plus USB in D2, which is the only OTF that is kind of legal here in Switzerland because the blade is so short. Just a fun little piece. I'm not a big expert in terms of OTFs, but this just was fun and I wanted to experience an OTF for the first time, so that's why it's in the collection. The blade is very thick, so it's not really a user or anything. I just have it for the mechanism and the fun factor, but it is D2, so a little bit a better steel than Boke uses for some other knives. And it's also made in collaboration with Cobra Tech automatic knife. So this is more of a fun little thing to have around. Then a smaller OTF, not OTF, but automatic knife that you can use is this one here, the side opening automatic Kershaw Launch 9. This has CPM 154 for steel, made in the US, a good functional clip, good three finger handle, and a functional blade shape that is absolutely great looking as well. This was also a gift from my girlfriend, so very cool OTF, probably one of my favorites here on these smaller knives. I would love to have around 5, but there are no stores in Switzerland that actually sell these. And I don't want to import automatic knives because it always can be a hassle, even though it technically would be legal. Then the last automatic knife is this one here. This is also a Berker Plus. This is a Shamsher, a collaboration with D-Rocket Design and Brno Blades, also featuring D2 for the blade steel. And on this version, we also have a copper kind of handle scale. It's a liner lock, lever release, side opening automatic. So more of a more traditional automatic mechanism design, but very cool. And these are actually legal in Switzerland. These are a special version made from a store here in Switzerland to be Swiss legal, so I had to have that as well. So these are my like mini autos that I can have here in Switzerland, and this is the kind of lower tier of the collection in terms of pricing and the way I store these knives. So I hope you enjoyed that. Now let's move on to the next tier up. So moving on into the next kind of tier of my knife collection, these are more higher end production knives, borderline customs, some kind of lower end customs, and some Shiro's, as well as a Rockstead, and some other things here that I consider higher quality or higher value than the knives you saw before. Let's start off here in the top left corner. These are also two of my comparison knives that I use regularly in my review videos. This is a Shiro Gorov F95NL, which means it's one of the lower priced F95s available. This is an L-Max steel, full titanium handle. You have a micarta handles, micarta inserts right there. Amazing action. This is just super smooth Shiro Gorov style action. Very, very nice. This is probably one of the knives with the best actions in the overall collection. The F95NL was a great purchase. I'm very happy to have this in my collection. It's also one of the larger knives in my collection, as you will see throughout the video, but just a gorgeous, clean design. And in the NL version, I think price-wise, these are certainly worth what they're charging in terms of overall fit and finish. And workmanship here, and the quality of the blade and the grind you're getting here, super thin, super slicey. Very impressed with the quality here of the F95NL, and certainly a great piece in the collection. Since it forms a team with the Neon Zero that we have here in the collection as well, as far as going Shiro Gorovs as well as a comparison duo, these will stay in the collection for a long time. This is the knife of the two that I carry more often because it's smaller and easier to carry, and it's also a little bit a higher end version of the Neo. It also costs about the same or a little bit more than the F95NL. Has an absolutely gorgeous backspace. You're loving the new style jimping, loving the new style blade shape. I was never a fan of the original Neon from Shiro Gorovs, but this just looks so much better in my opinion. This Neon Zero has a great, great action, a very strong detent. I had an NL version of the Neon Zero with the same kind of micarta inlays that had a pretty weak detent and also not the great backspace that we have here. So in the end, I sold that one and kept this one. And this is actually a thing that I also carry in terms of an EDC quite often. Great handle to blade ratio. Gorgeous ergonomics, nice and slim, great milling all around. Just an amazing knife, especially in this price point. It's very hard to get that much blade in such a small overall package. And coupled with the machining and the action on this, the Neon Zero is very hard to beat and will stay in the collection very, very long. Then we have this one here, which is one of the few customs in this kind of tier. This is the Cheburkov Knives Strich. This one has a laminated D2 blade, a colorized camel bone insert, titanium body, inset steel liner lock, and was made in 2017. It's a Russian custom knife running on washers, not on bearings. It's actually also an incidental front flipper, which wasn't a part of the design, I think, but you actually can front flip it quite easily. Super smooth, very gorgeous piece. Love the anodizing all around. Great clip with some jimping, so it's easier to extract out of the pocket. Screwed in inlays from the inside, and just an overall nice minimalistic Russian knife in a great size range, so it's very close to the Neon Zero here in overall sizing, but it's a thumb opener. It's also from Russia and it's a little bit dressed up. So this is the Cheburkov that actually stayed in the collection. In the last overview, I also still had my Toucan, which has been sold since then, which was a burlier, beefier folder, but this one fits my EDC style, and I just like how gorgeously it was made and all the parts about it, especially this very special blade here with the laminated D2. and that you can use it as a front flipper. Just put this over the top in terms of competitive nature with the Toucan. So that's the one that stayed in the collection. Then we have this one here. This is an Olamic Cutlery whippersnapper with the Wharncliffe blade shape in a very interesting version. I bought this one from Lamnia, which is a large retailer in Europe for knives, and they had a very large collection of these whippersnappers available. It was a model that always interested me, and this is just a version that this knife comes into a niche I haven't really covered in the overall collection. I love this green anodizing that I hadn't had on any other knife, and I think in this contrast with the blasted titanium, it comes out really, really well. Loved the look of the whippersnapper Wharncliffe blade. I like it more than the other blade shapes that are available. It is a front flipper, nice and smooth, middle finger flickable. Can also open it with the thumb. So very cool and different looking blade in the collection, much more modern, much more aggressive for such a small knife, and that's why it's still around. Hasn't been carried as much as I anticipated at first, because I am a little bit concerned about how this blasting is going to wear, but it gets carried from time to time, and it's just a fun knife to manipulate and use, and just a gorgeous looking whippersnapper, and one of the nicest one I have seen so far in terms of a full titanium version without any kind of inlays. Then we have this one here. This is a 3-inch non-flipper XM18 hinderer with some aftermarket scales here in micarta. You also have an aftermarket deep carry MXG gear pocket clip. I believe this is a 20 CV blade, yes. Runs on the bearings. It's also a triway version of the hinderer, as you can see by the logo right there. So pretty much the perfect hinderer for me. Love the size, love the ergonomics with that micarta. I'm very happy with how it looks and how it feels. So this is pretty much the perfect hinderer, and you certainly need to have a hinderer in the collection if you're a real live collector and you don't only collect customs. But this is a great knife, and I actually prefer it over the next one in the collection, which is one of my absolute grail knives when I started collecting knives. And this is, of course, a Sebenza 21 in single with black micarta inserts that is in the collection now for, I believe, almost 5 years or something. So very, very long time member of the collection, has been disassembled and reassembled quite a bit, also has been carried. A bit, you can see here on the clip there are some scratches, and this has also been a gift, I believe the first knife related kind of gift from my girlfriend, and for that I'm very, very grateful, and this will stay in the collection pretty much forever. I don't see myself selling this small 21. Good ergonomics, not great. Nice blade shape. I really like the blade shape here and how it performs. Of course, this is S35VN. So at the time of recording this video, this is not as top end as it was 5 years ago, but it just is a great knife here from Chris Reeve, and just a staple of the knife collecting hobby, and just a very, very well-known name, and also a thing you should actually at least have handled if you're considering yourself a real knife collector, just in my opinion. Of course, if you can't, it doesn't devalue your collecting. It's just something you should have experienced because it's such an important knife in the knife community. Not really the small, just one of Chris Reeve's knife. The same goes for this one here. This is a Rockstead Coup. This is like the smaller version of the Shin, which is probably the most popular Rockstead model. This is the less expensive version, so you don't have the satin or silver blade with the higher-end steel. This is the YXR7 steel with the black, very famous mirror-polished Rockstead DLC finish. We have a Ergal aluminum sandwich construction scale. We have the ray skin inserts on both sides here on this particular model. We have the nice overloop deep carry pocket clip. There are a bunch of versions of the Coup available. This is Coup number 199. The first versions had a not as nice of a clip. There's also Of course, as I said before, the one with the ZDP 189 blade, which are more expensive, but in my opinion, a Rockstead always looked like this. So the aluminum handles, black, the ray skin inserts, and then the absolutely gorgeous mirror polished blade that we have here in black. So that's why this is pretty much the quintessential Rockstead for me. Also, the size is perfect for my hand, and unfortunately the Koo is no longer made, so this will stay in the collection also for a really long time. This is pretty much the perfect Rockstead for me personally, in size, in looks and feel. And you saw it, the action here is incredibly smooth, and it just feels so much different than anything else I handled. So Rockstead really has a unique kind of feel and just way of building these knives. Also, cutting with them is amazing, but I have to be honest, I don't really hard use this. I cut open some envelopes and things. I also have carried it sometimes, but only times when I know I don't really need the knife. But it's just an absolutely gorgeous piece, and I love to have a Rockstead in the collection. I at some point had two. I also had a Chi, which is a Tanto version, very similar in overall construction. And in the end, I thought it wasn't really beneficial for the collection to have two very similar knives, and then I decided to settle on the Koo, and I'm very happy with that decision. Going back to a bit more affordable kind of area of this collection piece here is this one here. This is the Alliance Design EZE collaboration with Riyadh and Ray Laconico, as you can see here on the spine of the blade. This is one of my absolute favorite Riyadh collaborations. Unfortunately, no longer made, but I would love to see them making a version 2 of the EZE, just because it's such an absolutely amazing blade. Love the Tanto, probably one of my favorite Tanto blades ever made. You have a hollow grind main bevel, flat grind tip, very thick up front. We have also this very tiny swedge at the top as well. We have a bolster lock, micarta handle scales, S35VN blade steel on the Tanto blade. Quite thick blade stock, very Ray Laconico-esque light switch flipper. Nice and smooth, good minimalist clip, lanyard hole, and a great size at about 3.25 inch on the cutting edge. You even can come forward here, and you also have a sharpening chart. So this is just an absolutely gorgeous collaboration, probably one of the best Ray Laconico collaborations ever made, at least in my opinion. The Alliance Designs EZE, also something that will stay in the collection very long. Then we have the MDD-K by Wingman EDC, Tom Mayo, and Lee Williams with its kickstop mechanism. So the disappearing flipper tab. You can see here we have the flipper tab, and then boom, it's gone. Absolutely gorgeous overall design. I would love to have a hand rub satin version, but they came out after I already bought this, and I just couldn't find a good deal on those hand rub blades. I believe this is M390 as well, and mainly in the collection because of the overall iconic design of the Dr. Death flipper by Tom Mayo, and it's the only knife I have with some kind of a disappearing flipper mechanism, like kickstop or the mechanism by GTC knife. So that's why I still have this in the collection. Just an absolutely fun knife, and on this design I think the kickstop mechanism makes a lot of sense. I think this overall line looks so much better than the original flipper Dr. Death's, where you have this large unsightly flipper sticking off the bottom. So really nice knife, and I think this was the first model that Wingman EDC has ever released, and I think this is certainly a great folder. Good size, good ergonomics, good clip, very much a home run piece. Then we have two knives from Quiet Carry. Here we have the original Drift with the gorgeous knurling pattern that also adds quite a bit of grip here. We have Vanek steel, super thin blade stock, amazing EDC piece, overall super thin carrying, great deep carry wire clip. I never had any issues with the opening or the detent here on this opening hole. Lots of people have mentioned that they prefer the newer, like thumb stud version, but I think this is a much more cleaner design, carries better, doesn't have additional parts like the thumb studs, even removes a little bit of weight. So I'm a big fan of this hold version of the Drift, and this is also quite a bit a knife that I like to carry just because the ergonomics are great, the steel is amazing, and the cutting performance with that thin of a blade and the thin grind is out of this world. So this is probably my favorite knife that Quiet Carry has ever released. Also great size, completely rust proof. This is pretty much the only knife you ever need in a kind of EDC task for a knife. I really love the Drift. And then we have this one here, the perfect office kind of carry knife by Quiet Carry, the IQ. This is in LMAX steel, blasted titanium. Incredible action for such a small and lightweight blade. Super, super gorgeous, very unobtrusive looking, not even looking like a knife when it's closed, but you still get all the things you love as a knife nut. We have the overloop, 3D mill, deep carry pocket clip that works actually quite well if you don't have super thick pockets. A good, very, very nice sized blade for the overall size of the knife. Great blade to handle ratio, nicely centered, very smooth and snappy action here on the IQ. And this is a knife that I like quite a bit more than I actually anticipated, and it's still in the collection because it fills a niche that is very hard to fill, and it does it so, so well. So the IQ still a part of the collection. Then we have here the Berg Blades satin pop, dressed up with some zirconium pivot colors as well as a zirconium pocket clip. Unfortunately, he has never made a zirconium backspacer, otherwise I would certainly have got that as well. 20 CV blade, steel hollow ground blade, gorgeous clip point blade shape there, a little bit thick and heavy for its size, no internal milling, which would be a nice thing to see for the price here. But overall, I really like this knife. It's very, very comfortable. It works really well. The action is amazing because you have a little bit of a thicker and heavier blade. You can even middle finger flick it. And with those aftermarket kits that he has sold, where you can dress it up with some zirconium or Timascus, I think that is a great way to go. Nice and contoured handle scales. There have been some more models of these available with some inlaid materials. But I think this is certainly a knife that I really like, and one of the nicer production collaborations by knife makers. Berg Blades has some great designs even on fixed blades, and I like that I have this satin pop in the collection. So certainly a cool knife to take a look at. I believe maybe some of them are still available. Then we have the Micro Typhoon version 1 by Riyadh and Brian Addo from Sharp By Designs, still in the collection. Just an amazing knife. The action and the sounds are so different from anything else because you have the specially designed detent knob system here on the lock bar insert that is very proprietary to Mr. Addo. And I have something on the way, also designed by Mr. Addo, that may be replacing this. It's a little bit larger than this one, but I could see myself selling this if the one that I have coming in is as good as I expect. But this is just an amazing collaboration piece with Riyadh. Very, very smooth, amazing inlay work on the carbon fiber. And I actually bought this from a friend, Dr. Franke. So this also has some sentimental values to it. And I absolutely love this super clean blade that we have here. Also, it's quite a small version of a design by Jesper. Not Jesper Voxen, it's Brian Addo. Then the two we have left here in this tier before we get into the customs is here the Slim by Richard Rogers and Bestech, also a new addition for this year and also part of the top 10 knives of this year. Super lightweight, compact, great carrying folder with a great, great action. Absolutely amazing, featuring M390 on the steel. These were very hard to come by. At the moment, some of them get listed for around $330 on various sites, on Instagram as well as on Facebook. And these are just great knife. Very fidgety, very lightweight, nice milling here from Bestech, and really close to the original in terms of overall design. So a great, great knife to take a look at. Very fidget friendly and just a great lightweight carry. Some internal millings and everything. Great collaboration here by Richard Rogers and Bestech. And then another entry into the top 10 knives of 2021, the Oxwork Osprey EDX, built by Riyadh, designed by Eric Ox from Oxwork. Super smooth, just an absolutely gorgeous design with that diamond textured faux bolster. We have inlaid materials you can choose from. I went with micarta. Very, very good in ergonomics. We have a 3.25 inch blade, which is pretty much a perfect EDC blade. We have a hollow grind, which I'm a big fan of. We have a slot, so you can actually middle finger flick it if you want to. Can also thumb flick it, and it's just an absolutely amazing folder. You have a very unobtrusive and minimalistically designed nice carrying clip that is actually reversible with that nice inlay tab that he has here. It's not really that obvious. We have a little bit of a lot of screws here in this back portion, so screwing in the inlays from the inside would alleviate quite a bit of that, but other than that, this is just an amazing collaboration with Riyadh and just an absolutely gorgeously looking knife. And I see this one staying very long in the collection, just as the EZE has. These are probably one of my favorite flipper kind of collaborations from Riyadh with some custom makers. And now let's move on to the custom side of things. So now we are at the custom stage of the collection, and these are really the crown jewels of the overall knife collection of mine. I have amassed this pretty nice collection, if you ask me, of mainly front flippers, some flippers, and then also some manual opening knives. Here down the corner I also have one custom slip joint, and we will go through one on one by them. I'm very happy with the collection that I have here, and we will just move on through them one by one. So we have here the Skiff Drifter, my custom Skiff Drifter that was made to my specifications. This is the Drifter number 80. Absolutely gorgeous how this came out. We have the hand-rubbed satin and partly mirror-polished blade here. Then we have zirconium pivot colors with one line that was anodized bronze in the zirconium, as well as the bronze pivot screw and hardware. We have a zirconium backspacer and then a custom done satin finished zirconium pocket clip, not the regular kind of milled one. I like to have all the zirconium matching in the specific finish. Absolutely gorgeous knife. Love the overall lines of this folder. We have a mirror polished flat. We have a hollow ground blade. We have a very snappy action. Really, really smooth. We have a large flipper tab, which I'm normally not a big fan of, but here on this design, it actually works for me because flipping the knife is very, very comfortable. You also have some little cool details like the skiff marking here on the polished tang. Perfectly centered, polished spine of the blade. Just overall, this feels like a piece of luxury in the hand. You even can go in the foregrip. Absolutely gorgeous blade finish. And I'm very happy how it is to work with the folks at Skiff. They were very accommodating to all the wishes I had, and I'm very happy with this particular build. I had bought on the secondary market a Skiff Drifter before with some blue accents that I liked as well, and that was actually the initiator of getting one built by them for myself in the zirked out version that we have right here. So absolutely big fan of the Skiff Drifter and very happy to have it in my collection, this Skiff Drifter number 80 with all the zirconium on it. Of course, the titanium milling here is out of this world. Really, really well done by the Skiffs. This is a US made, CNC made custom. Of course, the blade grinds are done by hand. Then this one here is a knife that I love to show off. This is from a part-time maker from Belgium, Simon Strikkers, his tour model. Absolutely gorgeous knife. I won this actually in a lotto on his Instagram page. Absolutely amazing piece here. We have a steel that is a very proprietary European steel, very similar in terms of properties to N690. Great, great action. Very, very smooth overall. Just a very clean overall design, and just a very, very cool knife. Very nicely rounded titanium scales, blackened hardware, G10 backspacer, tapered handles, nice pocket clip and the maker's mark here on the lock bar. Cut out and very nicely done in Simmons Strickers. Really easy to recognize overall. Design language, certainly a maker to keep an eye on, and follow him on his Instagram. Links will be in the description below. Then here we have a newer addition for this year. This is the Herman Knives Sting, bought from Polish Custom Knives. This is an absolutely impressive folder from Poland by Bartosz Herman. This actually happens to be in M398. Amazing milling here as well with that kind of starburst pattern all along. Nice execution on the clip with that milled out area underneath. Gorgeous like jungle carbon fiber inlay by Fat Carbon. And just a very cool overall design, very functional blade shape, super ergonomic in my hands. Also a little bit a larger flipper tab, but actually very easy to actuate. And it also makes very interesting sounds because it's not a frame lock, it's actually an inset titanium liner lock. So it gets a little bit of resonance in that hollowed out and milled out titanium scale on the other side and makes this tingy sound. And that is very, very characteristic of these Herman knives. And this is just an absolutely gorgeous piece. You can see here the work on the backspacer really sets this knife apart. Nicely executed pivot. And of course, M398 is a steel that I haven't had any experience before this blade. And that was also a thing that drew me to this particular folder here from Herman Knives. Of course, it's a proprietary pivot, but you get the tool with that knives. Here we have the MT Knives Genesis 2.0 by Michel Timmermans out of the Netherlands. Absolutely gorgeous full-sized flipper here. Very, very meaty and handful of a knife. Absolutely gorgeous dark satin, hand satin finish on this blade. Absolutely gorgeous. Large zirconium bolsters, titanium bronze anodized pivot color, snakeskin carbon fiber scale, extremely large zirconium backspacer. So this knife has quite a bit of weight to it. Dark blasted titanium pocket clip, liner lock running on bearings, and extremely smooth and free falling. This really is an amazing piece by this Dutch maker that should actually have quite a bit more recognition. I will link all the Instagrams and websites, if I can find them, of these makers so you can check them out, because there are some that are not yet that popular on this in this collection, and I would love for you to go check them out if you're interested in their work. You can also see fit and finish and seams on that bolster is super well done. And I'm just an absolute fan of that blade finish that I asked for. He hasn't done that before, and he actually absolutely nailed it here on this Genesis 2.0. So very, very gorgeous knife here by Michel Timmermans of MT Custom Knives. Then my overall knife of the year 2021, the VC Edge Interface by Jason Van Camp out of the US. Absolutely amazing, super, super lightweight blade, 3.6 inch blade, 1.7 ounce overall weight here on this knife, with an amazing, super clicky action, very good noises it makes, very nice action. You see free falling and you feel like you have absolutely nothing in hand. It just weighs like absolutely nothing. It's super, super impressive. And you still get an S35 VN blade here that cuts very, very well. There is no real noticeable transition there. And just this changed my outlook on custom knife making as a whole. You have some nice texture in that carbon fiber. He numbers all of his interfaces. This is number 22. A nice deep carry clip that is actually reversible, if you haven't noticed that. So really cool engineering going on here. He has heavily skeletonized that inset titanium liner lock to get to that super, super lightweight overall weight. So this is an amazing piece. If you can get on in and a drop on these knives, do it right away. You will not be disappointed. This is like the space age of knife making. This is like the highest end in terms of modern high-end CNC machining, with the purpose of building a great folding knife that is as light as humanly possible, and he certainly has done that here. That's why this is my knife of the year for absolutely sure. The Jason Van Camp Interface VC Edge is the company name. And then we have another Polish knife bought from Polish Custom Knives. This is the JK knives, as you can see here on the handle, Dwarf by Jaroslav Kus out of out of Poland. And you can see this is an amazingly smooth knife, super cool, slimmed down, modern, very race car-esque overall design, very Shirogorov-like a little bit as well. Nice overall action, super, super smooth, a little bit light on the detent, but when you get the hang of it, you can easily deploy it, even if you have a very tiny kind of flipper tab, which I certainly like. You also got a matching 3D milled pocket clip, nice and slim overall right there. And you have a gorgeous M390 blade, hand rub satin finish. This is just an absolutely gorgeous piece. And another maker that you should certainly keep an eye on, he has at least one other model that he is producing at the moment, and I would highly recommend to check that out. And some of his knives are even available on Polish Custom Knives. The same goes for the Herman knives. For custom knives, these two makers are actually quite nicely available through a reputable dealer, which is Polish Custom Knives. So that's a thing that sets these two knives apart from many of the others here on the table. So these are actually quite easily acquired. There are not a bunch of them available, but some of them are actually available on Polish Custom Knives, so go check them out if you're interested in the Dwarf or the Sting or some other Herman knives. Then here we have pretty much a crown jewel of the collection. This is the Brad Zinker Urban Barlow Flipper in the 3.25 inch version with an absolutely gorgeous damasteel blade as well as a damasteel backspacer. Liner lock. This knife has cut me multiple times because it's that smooth, perfectly centered. We have mammoth handle scales, mammoth ivory. We have some nicely jeweled liners, and then we have large zirconium bolsters. A great action on that liner lock. Just a super, super gorgeous and absolutely well made Gentleman's Carry by Brad Zinker, which is one of my favorite overall makers. Just a beauty to behold and one of my few damasteel knives. The only other thing is that fixed blade you saw earlier in the collection overview. So a very, very nice knife right here from Mr. Brad Zinker. Also the jimping is this kind of checkering, same goes for the jimping on the spine right there. Lots of little details that just combine in this knife, absolute class in my opinion. Then a bit of less expensive custom knives that I have for quite a while here is this Shaper's Made slip joint, which is a screw down slip joint from down in Australia. It has some little quirks, so it's not perfectly made. There are some little fit and finish issues there. Also, the grind is not perfect, but it is a fun little knife. This also already went through the washer. I believe it's Nitro V on the blade steel. Great walk and talk. Nice overall way to deploy it. Nice functional little slip joint. We have micarta on the scales and carbon fiber for the bolsters, and a very functional tumbled finish. Shaper's has now focused mainly on building kitchen knives, but he is going back to slip joints as well as regular folders in 2022 as far as I know. So also check him out on Instagram if you're interested to see what he has going on in the future. This was a very inexpensive custom slip joint, so that's why he went a little bit a cruder overall finish. Now let's go down here to the front flipper section of the collection. We have here, of course, one of the most popular knives in the knife community at the moment. This is the 3.3 inch Gareth Bull Chamwari. If an M390 blade, pretty much unrivaled drop shoddiness. This is probably the knife that is better in terms of action than the Shirogorov I showed earlier. absolutely amazing in terms of action. It's a bit on the heavier side because there are no real internal millings here on these knives, but in terms of action, this is absolutely impressive. Some nice pop of color on the pivot screw, the standoff, as well as the screw in the back there. Absolutely gorgeous drop point blade shape with a nice hollow grind. Perfection 3D milled pocket clip. This nice, very signature over travel stop large pivot screw on the lock side, and just a gorgeous piece and much more ergonomic than the 3-inch Shambari I had in the past. Also goes great with the Seamaster there in terms of the blue touches. Absolutely amazing knife, and I actually was able to score this in a drop, so I have not overpaid massively for this, which is awesome. And this certainly will stay in the collection. I would love to have one of these with zirconium accents instead of the blue, just because I'm a big fan of zirconium, as I've seen before. So if somebody wants to trade a 3.3-inch Shambari with some zirconium accents instead of these blue ones on bearings, please let me know. Then we have another iconic front flipper. This is a Trevor Berger LEXK CFL with Mammoth inlay M390 or LMAX blade, I think. I have to reference the certificate for that. I believe it's an LMAX blade, and the absolutely gorgeous sheep's foot kind of blade shape that he has with the switch at the front. Great overall size, very ergonomic. Blue anodized clip, collars, as well as backspacer. Amazing milling all throughout, and an impressive action. Not as drop shotty as the Shambari, as you see, but very, very close in overall action, as you can see right here. And I love the inlay of the Mammoth, so bringing together the old and the new here on the CFL. Another Berger knife we have here is this one. This is the Urban EDC by Trevor Berger. His newest design, much smaller 3-inch blade, but ergonomically really well thought out, much more modern in the overall construction. Also amazing action, especially for the size. We have a full flat ground drop point blade shape. You can even middle finger flick it. Blind screwed pocket clip right there. Great EDC-able custom here. Really love that new addition for this year. Then also a new addition for this year is the A2A9 by Andre Van Heerden and Andre Thorburn. Probably one of my most carried customs this year. Absolutely great ergonomics, nice and slim carry. We have a lightning strike carbon fiber scale. Very functional pocket clip, zirconium pivot screw, CTS XHP for the blade. Very nice action overall. A great custom. This will also stay in the collection for a very long time, I suppose. Perfectly centered, great knife here from the A2 collaboration. Then we have also one of my earlier customs. This is the Brad Zinker Urban Trapper Arc in sandbar stack scales. We have LMAX for the steel, hollow ground, satin finished, great deep carry functional clip, very smooth and well made, very unobtrusive front flipper lip right there, absolutely gorgeous and easy to carry custom here from Brad Zinker. Then we have the Guy Pogetti Sanyo, also in LMAX with that darker blade finish and the most beautiful wooden handle scale I have ever seen on a folding knife. This is Tasmanian Blackwood, and it's just so gorgeous. It's very hard to capture on camera, but it has so much change when you are tilting the scales here. It looks like a different wood every time. Very gorgeous. The action here, of course, is pretty much perfect by Guy Pogetti, and it just looks like a fixed blade when it's open, which is absolutely well executed. Also has a clip, which Mr. Pogetti doesn't do that often. It's a bit of a shallow clip, but it actually bends quite a bit and works actually quite well. Easy to disengage, runs on bearings, of course. And just is a very, very prized possession of the collection, something you don't see that often on YouTube. And just in general, Mr. Pugetti is very high in demand here in Europe. Then here we have a Thierry Savidan Arcos with Wartok Ivory Scales, Zirconium Pivot, Zirconium Backspacer. Absolutely gorgeous piece, RWL for the steel. Just super gorgeous overall design, very nice in hand with that little divot for the blade. Gorgeous overall blade design, hand set and finish, liner lock, nice action, very minimal front flipper. You see, you almost can't see it, but it works perfectly well. It's a bit a thicker knife in the pocket. You also got the ceramic ball right there to get it in and out of the pocket, but it works actually quite well. Super ergonomic and just design-wise, a piece to behold, the Thierry Savidan Arcos. Then we have another amazing French maker, Rémi Lavial. This is his new Hardy model. Super gorgeous harpoon-style blade, RWL34. Gorgeously finished carbon fiber. Some very cool design work on the backspacer there. Nice clip. You don't get clips on these French custom knives very often, but I actually could manage to get one with a clip, which is very important to me. Very great overall size, pretty much a perfect French custom front flipper, the Rémi Lavial New Hardy. And then the last French knife we have here, probably one of the most iconic. This is a GTK small spear tack. This is the knife that was commissioned and previously owned by Mr. Dr. Franke, which is a friend of mine and a pretty big YouTube personality and neurosurgeon that is also quite into knives. And he actually sold that to me, which I'm very grateful for. This is probably one of the nicest French front flippers that I've ever handled. Great material combination, zirconium, and this is Westinghouse micarta with the pivot collar as well as the backspacer done in Westinghouse. Just absolutely gorgeous, and you can actually middle finger flick this, so really, really cool. Super thin cutting edge. I think this is also RWL34. I have to reference the card for that. Absolutely gorgeous size, perfect ergonomics, and just an amazing knife here by GTK Knives. And then we have three left to go. This one here is a very popular knife at the moment. This is the Roosevelt by OZ Machine Company. This is an early Roosevelt. I think this is model number 43, so we don't have the swatch, but we have the first knife with the stabby grind that I requested from Oz Machine Company. It's a great middle finger flicker, thumb flicker. Can also open it slowly and controlled. We got some zirconium on the backspacer, zirconium clip, and zirconium pivot. The gorgeous side cut carbon fiber scales. And we have a Z-finit blade with a hand drop satin finish on there. So this is just an absolutely great EDC carry piece. Super lightweight, nice and thin. And just a great, great piece overall. And pretty deserving of the hype that surrounds the Roosevelt. So very happy to have that one here in the collection. The Roosevelt 43 here by Oz Machine Company. And the last two, here we have the Casey Gray Squeegee that I got from the secondary market. There is a story about this knife. If you're interested, check out its review. We have zirconium thumb disc, pivot collar, as well as backspacer and pocket clip with a Westinghouse micarta scale. The steel is M390, runs on washers. And it's just a super ergonomic small little folder. Very nicely done. Has gotten some spa treatment from Casey Gray. Great maker to deal with. Even middle finger flicks now. Just a great compact folder here with some very nice and exotic materials. Looking great in the open as well as in the closed position. And it's also the only knife with a thumb disc in my collection. And the last knife is also a new addition for this year. This is the Ozarenko or Dog Custom Knives. Runa, the smallest version of the Runa series that is launching, full custom knife, CNC made handle and hand ground, amazingly hollow grind drop point blade, 20 CV blade steel, made in St. Petersburg, Russia. This also has an absolutely incredible action, as you can see right here, middle finger flickable as well, and super ergonomic and gorgeous. So these are all the custom knives that I have here in the collection, and I hope you like the overall overview here of my collection. If you did so, please give it a thumbs up. If you have any questions, put them down in the comment section below, and follow me here on YouTube as well as on Instagram at 7ready_knife_reviews. Thanks again for all the support during the year. We will do lots of more content in 2022, and I would be honored if you would support me there and watch the video. So thanks again for watching. Have a nice day and goodbye.